I want to start with a story of John. His Dutch name is a bit different, but I'm not going to bother you with his name, okay? It's John. We decided to call him John, and he is part of that decision. He's 8 years old, and a year ago, John's dad committed suicide after a period of hard domestic violence. 4 days after his father died, John said he didn't want to be sad any longer, and since that moment, he didn't shed a tear. He takes responsibility for many tasks in the house and acts as the man and the father in the house. He coaches his little brothers and his mother. He explains how to cut the grass in the garden, when to fill the dishwasher, and he rushes his brothers in the morning to make sure that they arrive at school in time, and so on. He takes a lot of tasks on his shoulder. Since a few months, the temper tantrums are in charge. They grow in frequency as well as in proportions. John is sent into therapy to work on the traumatic experiences in the past and to stop the temper tantrums. He tells everything is going very well in the conversation. He avoids and turns down each question and the difficulties, and he refuses to talk about the difficulties or about his father. Each question that I ask sounds as an interrogation and makes him feel as if he is the problem. Yeah. Now, my toolkit in narratives, and I look to Mark, he's the question specialist, are questions. So each question, no way to go. And we get stuck. Another problem is that other people found it a very good idea that he came into therapy, but he is not the one who wants to come into therapy. So, we have a few problems, yeah? Because when we start to talk with children in therapy, there is a hierarchy, if you wish or not. I'm tall, they are small. I have a lot of words. They don't have that mass of words. They already have been to school, most of them, and I don't know, but in school, I think it's the same here in Britain, there you learn how you have to answer questions. You have to answer them in the right way. And please look to me in the face when we are having questions. Yeah? And if you want to answer, please, the right answer. Then you get good points. So children also want to be a good child in class. And they don't know what is the context of therapy or what is therapy about. So before you know it, you are in a kind of relationship where you together get locked up or something like that. Yeah? Even in the context of trauma, yeah? And I think it's the same over here in Britain or in a lot of parts of the world, that there is a strong belief that trauma often has to happen in a separate room by experienced people who have real trauma expert certificates, and we have to work the trauma through. That's how we say it in Dutch. You have to work the trauma through. What is happening to your children if I start with those ideas in my conversations? So that means that my position, or my preferred position, from the narrative perspective, being decentered and influenced, becomes very difficult. And something more that I sense is that my creativity is, or my playfulness is gone, completely gone. Even more, I would say, because very often it are the parents who bring the children into the room. And parents, I think there are some parents here, and when your child is born, we all have an idea where we hope that our child will arrive when it's 18 or 21. And I have the first plan, but I think it's much higher. I have to adjust the picture. It has to be much, much higher. Yeah. But we don't take into account as a parent that there are a lot of pitfalls, that there are a lot of obstacles. And the moment that in life and in our growth together with our children, there appear huge pitfalls or huge obstacles, we sense helplessness. We lose our agency towards our children. Pretty often, I think, we don't see any longer that we can be meaningful for them. So what happens, parents bring their child into therapy after traumatic experiences with a great, great urge. Please help my child. And I can't do it any longer. So if we accept that and we take the child into therapy, what are we doing with the position of the parent at that moment? Am I going to be a better parent then? Is that what we want to be to the family? So a lot of things that kept me puzzling, because also parents put a lot of pressure on my shoulders that make even drop down my creativity and my playfulness even more. And then there is also a very important sentence that goes very much through my head. Don't repeat what has been done already. And Ellen Jenkins added a very beautiful phrase next to that. And he said, how can we intervene without reproducing practices of abuse or violence? How can we children not force to speak? There is a strong belief that we don't get through the traumatic experiences as long as we do not speak. So speaking is the best solution. But aren't we, in the case of John, forcing him to speak if he says, I don't want to speak? And my toolkit are questions. Do you see? There comes a lot of blur in my head. Where do I have to go? How do I have to go? So can we invite children and youngsters to speak and think from a different position and step into a new kind of relationship of speaking, so that maybe new and other things can be said or can be questioned? Yeah? I go back to John. Yeah? After a while, in the conversation, the first conversation, it becomes very clear that injustice is an important theme. It is not fair that I have to come over here. It's not fair that I have to speak. So we pick up out of that conversation that injustice is a very important theme. To map the injustice, I ask him, oh, what would happen if you were a king? And if you were a king, how would your country look like? And what would be the rules in your country? And how would you deal with those rules? So I start to become a journalist. And he starts to become a king. And I put a crown on his head and we draw his country. I present you his country with a castle and a lot of provinces, how do you say, regions?
Yeah.
Districts?
Yeah.
Yeah. And he all gives them a name. But we also start to develop some rules in the country. Yeah. And one of the rules is you aren't allowed to die without permission in your country. A quite interesting rule. So I, as an inhabitant, someone who lives in the country, a citizen of his country, asks, and if I don't follow the rule, what is going to happen? So we start to have a whole conversation about rules, but even more, we can start to scaffold some conversation about what is so important for you as a king, that those rules get installed, and that people follow those rules. And where do you want to engage your citizen in when you install those roles? So we have a very nice conversation with the king of, I tell you, it's Appelblauw Zeelandia. It's a bit Dutch, but that's the name of the country. There comes another rule. Angriness isn't allowed. So we start to externalize a bit. Mr. Anger isn't allowed. So in a quick hurry, we prepare, or we make Mr. Anger. I present you Mr. Anger. He has short legs, Mr. Anger. But he can run very fast, he says, in his country. He can do all the districts in a real hurry. Yeah? And as a king, he has a wonderful idea. Let's send Mr. Anger to Antarctica. I present you Antarctica, and you see some brown things on the mountains. This is our get lost signs. Right. As a citizen, I keep on being very curious, very interested. We have a very lovely chat. Not about traumatic experience, not about nothing else, but he wants to come back next time. So we have some chats further on, and he comes a few weeks later, and he's really angry when he comes in. School is stupid. Okay. But he still doesn't want to talk about what happened, he doesn't. So I have to be playful in a certain way. So I ask, oh, school is stupid. What if you were a director of the school? Or the school head? What would be the rules then? I present you the school. Yeah? There is a tree in the school. He wants more green, less space for sport, because he hates all those boys playing sport. More space for fantasy. And suddenly there comes another thing that he says, and I show it. He says, going to the swimming pool in silence. I don't understand that rule. As a child in his school, and he is a headmaster. So I ask some curiously questions about what about and why. So he says, oh, I will show you on the map. So we go on the computer and we go to Google Maps. I present you Google Maps. If you look very clearly, most that side, you see the playground of the school with the tree. You can see? Yeah? And to go to the swimming pool, they don't take the main road to the swimming pool, but they take a little backyard road. So they go that small road next to the playground, and they go around, and then you see a lot of small things over there. What we discover, I discover, is that they pass by the graveyard. You see? They pass each week besides its father. And people, children, when they go to the swimming pool, they yell, they sing, the buh, buh, buh. So that's very horrible. So we have a conversation again about what he wishes as a director. Not as John. We keep on in our roles, we are strict in our roles. I respect his idea of I'm not going to talk as John and we are not going certain directions. But we talk about what it means as a school director and where he wants to take care of by this role. You can see? So, and we start further on scaffolding. This means, I go back, that there is something very interesting if we start to play with roles. Yeah? I can at a certain moment start to ask questions that I, from my position as a therapist, can't ask. Or I get dissented, they get heard by him as interrogation, or he has to answer in the right way. And also, when he gets a different place to stand and a different role and position, he can start to talk about things and say, oh, but that's not me. Or he can be a king and say to me, shut up. I want another question. So we get in a kind of different social relationship that opens new possibilities, which for me is very important. Yeah. So we are on the road. I have a bit of a sense that we are on the road in mapping injustice for him and what it's all about. And I don't know if you also can sense it, but what I very much see when children have experienced traumatic experiences, they get a sense of being very worthless, they get alienated, and they don't look any longer around. Yeah. So they get a sense of that they are the only one on this planet, the only one on this planet who feels, who senses what they sense, or do act like they do. So they get even more alienated from the persons that are important for them, and they get more alienated for what matters to them. So, I have some questions. Because I thought, if he has a sense that he is the only one, yeah, I have some questions for you. Is there anybody here in this room that has never been angry? Is there someone in the room who had already once a visit of a kind of Mr. Anger? Okay, okay. Everybody, please?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. Is it a male or a female? Mr. or Mrs. Anger you have? A Mr.? Okay, most, yeah, okay. Can also be transgender. Do you have clear when he comes the most? Or when he is the biggest? Yeah, I see people, okay. Do you know what his nasty tricks are? Yeah, yeah, some have, yeah. And do you know what is good food for Mr. Anger? Okay, yeah. And what makes him, what do you have to do when he enters the room? What makes him do when he enters the room? Yeah? And is he also entering your body or occupying your body? Yeah? And some other question, do you tell others about Mr. Anger? Or do you choose who or when? A lot of questions. Departing from the idea that John isn't talking any longer with other people about Mr. Anger that visits him, that he has a sense of alienation, that he is disconnected from what matters for him and from the people that matter to him. So I ask him, what if we go for a real academic research project? What is there to discover about Mr. Anger? Yeah. And he's into it. He becomes a real researcher. Yeah. Scientifically checked out. Yeah. It has to be evidence-based. So I ask him, if you could go on a research project, what questions would you ask? What are you eager to get known about Mr. Anger? And he has a lot of questions. We develop together questions. Yeah? And those questions we're gonna ask out of the road. Yeah? We have a large building in Antwerp with a lot of trainees, with a nice administration office. So we go on the road with his questions about Mr. Fear, and he is my cameraman. Because he isn't eager to ask the questions. He's a bit afraid for the answers. Yeah? And he needs a place that is safe enough to stand. So he's behind the camera and I have the mic. Yeah? And we go around. We discover wonderful things about Mr. Anger. But just the relief that everyone has a kind of Mr. Anger, not the same, not in the same proportions and on different moments, but they all have. It's a secret, but everyone has. So, you're okay. Yeah. But can you imagine a little bit what that can mean for him? What kind of connection that starts to get realized? So, he's really excited. After our inquiry, we inform his mom about our research project. And she's very interested, and she does a bit of small bit of outside witness on what we discovered about Mr. Eric. So next time he says, we're going to do it on Mrs. Sadness. Very well. We go for Mrs. Sadness. And we go on. We keep on doing our research project. It works very well. At a certain moment, he says, oh, what do people when somebody died? And what do they keep with them? Interesting question. So we develop some more questions about that thing, and we go on the road. I take you with me.
We met in
the administration office, a colleague of mine.
So you have to know, he is the cameraman. So the camera is moving.
In uw familie of in uw vriendenkring die al gestorven is en die je heel graag zag?
Ja, mijn papa.
Oh. En is dat al lang geleden?
Vijf jaar is dat geleden. Ja.
En miste die persoon soms?
Goh, ik mis die heel erg. En... vond ik dat lastig.
En heb je ook zo'n idee wat dat je dan mist op zo'n momenten?
Wat mis ik dan? Eens denken. Ermee praten, dingen samen doen. Dat ik dingen kan vertellen die ik goed heb gedaan of die moeilijk zijn. Dat mis ik soms wel, ja.
En zijn er dingen dat je toen achter dat hij gestorven was, die je bewaard hebt?
Bewaard of bewaard?
Bewaard. Dat kan grief zijn, foto's zijn.
Ik heb een heel mooie foto die Lien heeft gemaakt, die mijn dochter heeft gemaakt. En dat die heel, heel lachend opstaat. Ja. En die foto heb ik bewaard.
En heeft hij een speciaal pleitje waar je hem bewaard hebt?
Hij staat op de grond, op mijn bureau. Waar ik soms zit te lezen of zit te werken. En dan lacht hij soms naar mij. Dat vind ik eigenlijk heel leuk. Dat hij soms gewoon altijd er zit te lachen. Ja.
Is er nog iets van grief ook van hem dat je bewaard hebt?
Mijn papa heeft ook een foto waar hij op lacht. Die staat de kaft.
Ja, zo'n mooie foto waar hij op lacht. Zo, zo bijna een clowneke. Ik weet niet hoe lief. Ja.
Van mij is ook gestorven.
Ja, ja. Nog iets.
It was the first time he said that. Yeah. And it's not that I'm going on a research project where I have a clear destination or a fixed destination. No, we are co-researchers. So we go together and I don't know what is going to come. So we had interviewed 5 people. Yeah. And after that interview, we came at my room where we have conversations. And before we entered, said, oh, Sabine. So you never forget that. So I started to see what he was into, what those questions meant for him, and what the answers could mean for him. It was beautiful. And he said, we had already done maybe 50 interviews, I don't know. But we ran all over the place with our camera. And he said, the second thing, you never interviewed me. So I said, would you like? Can I be your journalist? I'm really honored. So we enter the room and I am very honored to get interviewed. I'm strictly on the interviewer chair, not a therapist. Eh?
Het is nu al het tweede jaar misschien, is het zo?
Denk het wel, hè?
Ja. Mis je die persoon soms?
And I ask his questions.
Ja. En mis je die veel?
Ja.
Ja. Wil dat dan zeggen dat je er veel aan denkt?
Ja.
Ja. En wat mis je dan het meest?
Zijn
lekker
oranje.
Zijn lekker oranje, ja. En zijn er nog zo dingen die je mist? Dingen die jullie samen deden, zeg wat?
Zijn grapjes.
Oh, weet je nog wat dat zijn beste grap was?
Nee.
goes on and we can start scaffolding again. Can you see? Okay. Because what you start to see is that those voices and those stories that come in can sound for him as a kind of acknowledgement. It exists, what I feel. And I may feel what I feel, or I can do what I do, and I stay connected with other people. It is a kind of reference that comes, yeah? A kind of normalization that can come, and also support. Yeah? And I wrote it all down, but what it also brought, and it was very funny, I show it, there came a new theory of emotions. We did really, it's didn't show it yet anywhere, but I present you a new theory of emotions. Because Mr. Anger is no longer Mr. Anger, but it's Monsieur Anger. He lives in Paris beneath the Eiffel Tower. And his mother and father, and that's very interesting because that's what he discovered through all those interviews, is Mrs. and Mr. Disappointment and Disillusion. And the little sister of Mr. Angriness is Mrs. Sadness. And he created a whole family, and I think it's a wonderful new emotional theory. I don't know if she will get published in scientific papers, but we will try, we will try. At a certain moment, all the interviews go further on, I told you in the beginning, his big dream was become a policeman. It was about injustice, injustice, yeah. And I don't know how it came, but I was a bit excited about all what we were doing, and I said, oh, we never interviewed a policeman. He said, oh yeah, let's interview a policeman. I thought, gee, can I find a policeman? I didn't find one, I found two. They chose themselves, one police woman, the woman chose, I'm going in uniform, and the other in Dutch we say burger,
in
And on his questions again, we made a new questionnaire. I cut it a bit because it was a 1 hour interview.
Well, that's what you said, Monsieur.
And he's behind the camera as outside the witness again.
In the right, that is safe in the top in it. And then also, in the police.
Of all police. All police. Yeah. Weet je dan dat het zo belangrijk is om er niet de mensen te zeggen wat dat het probleem is? Je moet een beetje tussen de
lijntjes. You have a bit to imagine when you are drunk how it would feel, how the words would sound and what would touch you. Clear, the policemen were not informed about all names.
Bijvoorbeeld, in onze van ik vind dat niet leuk en ik vind dat niet leuk. Dat gaat niet. Je kunt niet met een miljoen mensen gaan vragen van wat vind je leuk. Dus wij moeten als mensengroep moeten we dingen aan de papier zetten. Ik heb nog een moeilijke vraag, maar ik weet niet als de politie daar wel durft op antwoorden. Wij vroegen ons af, want niet alle mensen zijn even vriendelijk. Of soms moet je misschien wel in de dingen doen waarvan je zegt. Wij vroegen ons af, zou de politie ook zo soms iets zeggen dat ze soms een keer bang zijn? Dat ze, mogen als politie soms bang zijn?
Absoluut.
Dat mag.
At the end, he was almost sitting on the belly of the police.
Yeah.
show this because every story, every voice that we bring in brings new stories. And they can develop new ideas. So I figured it out as a kind of process of becoming also. And each questionnaire and each story that comes in is a temporary result in the process of becoming for me. Yeah. And we don't know where we will end. And it will never end, you could say. But that's what we're going. And you can choose which voices you first bring in, and you can negotiate with him which voices he would be interested in. All the children, parents, policemen, and each voice has a different weight. Opens up other perspectives or other meanings, and so also other stories, and can bring us to other places. So I don't want one interview, not at all, because then it becomes the truth. I don't want two because the golden rule in family therapy, I think, not two because then you bring somebody in a dilemma. Which stories do I have to choose? But no, I want multiple perspectives. Like Deleuze said, multiplicity, how do you, yeah, multiplicity, it starts. That's what we invite into the room. Yeah? And how can we organize that without forcing them to speak, but that they go together with me on a discovery tour? And not only that we go together on a discovery tour, but that we can take the parents also with us. So we started, in the meanwhile, we do a lot of those questionnaires, even with adults, not only with children, but also with parents and so on. But we can start with people that are not too concerned, or are not concerned. They know nothing about the situation of the child. Because otherwise you get that they start to care again for the child. And that's what I want to avoid. He is the owner of his questionnaire and of his questions. And people don't have to care for him or her. So that's also why he can stand behind the camera. And often they come out of it door and they start to develop further on questions. But we start behind it, so that they can choose to what they want to listen and to what not. Yeah. Sometimes we do it by email and we send emails around. But it also means when we film it or we do it by email or we get letters, that they can re-look it at it, that they can reread at it. So it becomes again a temporary result in the process of becoming, that it can always get us a bit further. At the end, we also interviewed his mom. So as last, with the questions. But he didn't want to question his mother at first. And the first period, not at all, because he wanted to take care of his mother. He knew very well that those questions would make her sad. But step by step, by that she was at each step of our process outside the witnesses, he started to see also that she could have the sadness. And that it was okay. So at a certain point he said, yeah, now I want to question my mom. It was a beautiful interview. At the end, we did also a diploma, a graduation moment, and we invited more than 15 people that we interviewed. Yeah, they were all at the room, and his two little brothers, his mother, were also there. So I show a little bit of that. teleurstelling, maar ook wat je doet als je iets ergs overkomt of een dierbaar iemand verliest. We waren erin zeer goede vragen te stellen en veel verschillende mensen waren bereid om aan zijn onderzoek op een heel positieve manier mee te werken. De diploma is uitgereikt op 19 december in de Interactieacademie. Was Michael White that said, feel free to develop your own maps. So we developed our own map of the questionnaires in different steps, and I can assure you it's big fun. And it offers you a lot of new stories. I discovered a lot of things of my colleagues, a lot of precious things. And so it doesn't not only relink the child with his family and with what matters, but it relinks also a lot of people with each other. It brought a lot of conversations in our team about topics that we otherwise never talk with each other about. So also the people who are interviewed by him or her get changed. What Barbara Meyerhoff said, he, by listening to the interviews, get changed, but also the interviewers themselves afterwards can, when they get the results of our quest and our research project. An interesting thing is also that we started for girls much more to do glossy magazine questionnaires, because they are more interested in that. It's, I don't know, maybe a gender issue. There's just one other last thing I want to tell. 2 minutes. Yeah. The story of John is already a few years ago that we started with those projects, and he was one of the first that we started to develop his map. And a few months ago, I got a telephone call from his mom. And she said, yeah, John would like to come again. So I said, stupid me, I said, oh, what's the problem? And she said, wonderfully, she said, I don't think there is really a problem, but he wants to research some things. All right. So he came, and now we are on a research project, and it's also really wonderful, because we are on a research project now to whom, where, and when do you talk about a dad that committed suicide? And that you are from a family where there was a lot of violence. And the second topic that we are now on a research project is his little, the youngest brother was 2 years when all those things happened, so he doesn't remember a thing, but now he is crying a lot and missing his father. So that's for him so confusing. What makes that I don't have those feelings and I knew my father, and then what do I have to do? So now we are engaged by email with a lot of other youngsters who lost their mother or their father by suicide, and how they deal and feel and what makes a difference if it was when you were 2 years, 10 years. And I discover again, it makes work really fun. Thank you.